Good evening, and let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your living and active word, sharper than any two-edged sword. And we ask that you'll give us ears to hear and hearts to obey. In the name of Jesus, our only Lord and Savior. Amen. What is your spiritual history? That's one of my favorite questions to ask people if the moment is right and they have the time available to give a full answer. What is your spiritual history? In other words, how has God been at work through your background and through your life to bring you to the point you're at now? It's always a fascinating and instructive and encouraging question to ask and to hear people's answers. Try it on somebody sometime. So, this evening, this is part two of our journey through the Apostle Paul's letter to the Galatians. Last Sunday, if you were here, you'll know that we majored on chapter 1, verses 1 to 10. And this evening, we're going to be looking at chapter 1, verse 11, through to chapter 2, verse 14. So that includes the second part of chapter 1 that I didn't get to properly last week, as well as what we've just heard from chapter 2. Because, as a matter of fact, 1:11 through to 2:14 is all of a piece. It starts on page 972 in the Bibles. It'll help to have that open. So what we have got here is the Apostle Paul's spiritual history, his backstory, if you like. And it is fascinating and encouraging. But it's more than that, because it's vital that we grasp the truth that Paul is a God-appointed apostle and that his teaching comes direct from God. It's through this teaching that we come to know God and to enter his eternal kingdom. It's that important. And this issue is given particular sharpness by the fact that Paul was not one of the original apostles. He did not spend 3 years traveling with Jesus and watching him and learning from him. So there are four lessons about the apostolic authority and teaching of Paul from his life history that he wants to pile drive into our hearts and our minds. And I've summed them up in my headings, and I warn you now that they are not particularly snappy. First of all, then, Paul's apostolic authority and teaching came direct from Christ by revelation. This is 1:11 through to the first part of verse 16. Paul's fundamental claim, which is at the root of all his authority and teaching, is there in verses 11 and 12, where he says, "For I would have you know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel. For I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ." Everything hangs or falls on this. Is Paul's gospel God's gospel, or does it just come from human minds? Paul's claim is a massive one with cosmic significance. Is it true, or is it made up? The other evening we saw One Life, the story of Nicholas Winton and his rescue of Jewish children from Prague as the Nazis were invading in 1939. It's in the cinemas at the moment. And whenever I go and see a film that says it is based on a true story, the first thing I always want to do afterwards is to find out whether it really was true or whether it was essentially made up for the sake of good drama. Well, Paul gives us the truth about himself, starting with his life before he met the risen Jesus. Verses 13 and 14, "For you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. And And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people. So extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my fathers. In those days, Paul, Saul as he was, had a religion that was man-made. It was a deadly distortion of the true faith of Abraham and Moses, the traditions of my fathers, as he calls it. But he was deeply committed to it. He was sincere, but sincerely wrong. And it led him into violent persecution of the early disciples of the crucified and risen Messiah, Jesus. But he went through a radical transformation when he met the risen Jesus on the road to Damascus. That's why he could be an eyewitness of the resurrection, because he met the risen Jesus. And in one irresistible divine move, he was converted to faith in Christ and called to take the good news of his Lord and Savior to the world beyond the Jews, to the Gentile world. Verses 15 and 16. But he who had set me apart before I was born and who called me by his grace was pleased to reveal his son to me in order that I might preach him among the Gentiles. For all Paul's bitter hatred of Jesus before he met him, and despite the fact that Paul was the chief of sinners, as he calls himself elsewhere, this had always been God's plan for him, and God cannot be thwarted. So he gave to Paul, by direct revelation, the message that he wanted him to preach to the Gentiles. Is it fake or is it real? That's a big question in the art world. Banksy's artworks can go for a small fortune. Game Changer apparently was sold for £16.8 million. And not surprisingly, in the light of that, there are apparently millions of pounds worth of fakes, bogus Banksys. And there's a whole Banksy organization called Pest Control, through which he certifies the authenticity of his work. Paul is the real thing. That is lesson one. Paul's apostolic authority and teaching came direct from Christ by revelation. Secondly, Paul's apostolic authority and teaching were independent of the other apostles. This is Paul's point in chapter 1, verses 16 to 24. Here is the key question. Is Paul subordinate to the other apostles? Answer, no. His teaching did not come from them. For years, he had hardly any contact with them. I'm not going to read out that passage, but this is what happened. So after his conversion, he had 3 years of private tuition from the Holy Spirit away in Arabia and Damascus. This is what he tells us, without consulting anyone, without going to Jerusalem where the other apostles were based. And then after 3 years, he spent just a fortnight in Jerusalem with Peter, Cephas, as he calls him, Aramaic for Peter. He did not meet any of the other apostles at that stage except James, the brother of Jesus. That would not have been long enough for any kind of serious study. And then he went off again back to Syria and Cilicia, miles from any other apostle. The churches in Jerusalem knew him by reputation, but not personally. And so it was for 14 years. By then, his ministry and his message were established and embedded. And only then did he go to spend time with the apostles in Jerusalem. For years, I've been hearing and reading about Tolkien's Lord of the Rings, but only secondhand. I had never read it, but I did last year. And very, very moving, I found it, especially that momentous journey of Frodo and Sam across the murderous land of Mordor to Mount Doom. At last, I have first-hand knowledge of the Lord of the Rings. From the very start of his life as a disciple of Jesus Christ, Paul's teaching was not second-hand from the other apostles. It was first-hand from Christ himself. That's lesson two. Paul's apostolic authority and teaching were independent of the other apostles. And that is going to be vitally important later on, as we'll see. Thirdly, Paul's apostolic authority and teaching were recognized and accepted by the other apostles. That is what Paul tells us about in chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. Paul was an apostle, but he was not the only apostle chosen to be an eyewitness to Jesus, appointed and authorized by Jesus to teach the truth about him to the world. Nor was Paul a kind of freelancer with a different message to theirs. It mattered that all the apostles were on the same page. So let's go through this and see what Paul wants us to know. Chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Then after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas, taking Titus along with me. I went up because of a revelation and set before them, though privately before those who seemed influential, the gospel that I proclaim among the Gentiles, in order to make sure I was not running or had not run in vain. So he wasn't summoned to Jerusalem as a subordinate. He went because God told him to. And he wasn't needing their seal of approval. He wanted to make sure they were not going to undermine his ministry. Verse 3, but even Titus, who was with me, was not forced to be circumcised, though he was a Greek. So that confirmed they were teaching the same as him, that those saved by grace through faith in Christ did not also need to keep the old covenant law, including circumcision. That would be to enslave them again and take away their freedom in Christ. But that was the particular point of dispute and conflict in the church then. So he goes on, verses 4 and 5. Yet because of false brothers secretly brought in, who slipped in to spy out our freedom that we have in Christ Jesus, so that they might bring us into slavery, to them we did not yield in submission even for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you. That's the key thing for Paul. His apostolic teaching of the gospel must not be compromised. Not one bit. And not even for one short moment. A lost world depended on that. How vital that is for us to take on board. Verse 6, and from those who seemed to be influential, what they were makes no difference to me. God shows no partiality. Those, I say, who seemed influential added nothing to me. Again, he stresses that the other apostles, with whom he was equal in authority and whose human status he was not concerned with, did not amend his teaching at all. Verses 7 to 10. On the contrary, when they saw that I had been entrusted with the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been entrusted with the gospel to the circumcised, for he who worked through Peter for his apostolic ministry to the circumcised worked also through me for mine to the Gentiles. And when James and Cephas and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given to me, they gave the right hand of fellowship to Barnabas and me, that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. Only they asked us to remember the poor, the very thing I was eager to do. So, Paul's apostolic authority and teaching and ministry were recognized and accepted by the other apostles as God-given. And they also recognized that Paul had been called by God as the primary apostle to the Gentiles, the non-Jews. That's most of us. Just as Peter was the primary apostle to the Jews. Now, relatively speaking, in relation to the length of this letter, Paul has spoken a lot about this issue. You might think that he is laboring the point, but he needed to. His apostolic authority was constantly under attack, and it still is. In fact, you could say that the current conflict in the Church of England over sexual ethics comes down to whether or not we should accept Paul's writings as God's word written. So that's lesson three. Paul's apostolic authority and teaching were recognized and accepted by the other apostles. And then Paul gives us a case study to hammer home the significance of those first three lessons. So, fourthly, Paul's apostolic authority and teaching were brought into sharp focus by his opposition to Peter's temporary fall into hypocrisy. Take a look at chapter 2, verses 11 to 14. First of all, verse 11. But when Cephas, that's Peter, came to Antioch, where Paul was, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. Imagine the scene. So Paul does not hesitate to use strong language, even about the Apostle Peter, when he sees Peter going off the rails. So what's been happening? Well, he explains from verse 12. For before certain men came from James, he, Peter, was eating with the Gentiles. But when they came, he drew back and separated himself, fearing the circumcision party. And the rest of the Jews acted hypocritically along with him, so that even Barnabas was led astray by their hypocrisy. But when I saw that their conduct was not in step with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas, before them all, if you, though a Jew, live like a Gentile and not like a Jew, how can you force the Gentiles to live like Jews? Now, the Apostle Peter understood the gospel. God had taught him that faith in Christ meant that the food laws of the Old Covenant no longer applied. So he had been living and eating alongside Gentiles and Jew alike. The old social separation of Jew and Gentile had been broken down by the gospel. But Peter had allowed himself to be intimidated by this Judaizing party group from Jerusalem who were insisting that this apostolic teaching was mistaken. Not for the first time, Peter's courage failed him. He gave in to fear, and his cowardly compromise was contagious and poisonous. Peter's standing in the church made his compromise influential. Even Barnabas, Paul's own partner and friend in ministry, even Barnabas gave in to the peer pressure. But Paul was having none of it. As we've seen so clearly, he understood very well his own apostolic authority. He understood the implications of this God-given gospel teaching. And on this occasion, Peter was in the wrong. And letting that go would have had far-reaching, long-lasting, and devastating consequences for the church. This was a first-order gospel issue. So, says Paul in verse 11, I opposed him to his face. And what is the particular fault that he skewers? Hypocrisy. There's no indication here that Peter was teaching falsehood, but his behavior was not in line with what he knew to be true. He was being a hypocrite, and he was leading others into hypocrisy. And because his behavior was public, he had to be opposed publicly too. Lesson four, Paul's apostolic authority and teaching were brought into sharp focus by his opposition to Peter's temporary fall into hypocrisy. Now, there is an obvious application here to the situation in the Church of England. I spoke about this last week. You can catch up on that online if you'd like to do so. But let me add this. The House of Bishops is doing two things. On the one hand, it is saying that there is no change to the Church of England's doctrine of marriage. What is that? It is the apostolic doctrine learned directly from Jesus through the apostles that marriage is between one man and one woman for life, that sex is for marriage, and that all other forms of sexual activity are immoral. That is God's way for the good of all of us, however countercultural it may be. And the House of Bishops, on the one hand, says it is upholding that teaching. On the other hand, it is also encouraging and commending the blessing of same-sex sexual relationships, whether inside or outside of same-sex marriage. And the effect of this, in the end, is to abandon apostolic sexual ethics entirely. And in doing that, the House of Bishops is fatally denying and undermining the very apostolic teaching on marriage that it says it is upholding. That is a flat contradiction. So there is now a deep-seated institutional hypocrisy at the heart of the Church of England hierarchy. And following the example and the teaching of the Apostle Paul, it has to be opposed, and opposed publicly. That's why we've written to the bishops of this diocese, reaffirming what Ian and Ramsay and I said in a meeting with the Bishop of Berwick. This is something that we reported last year, but let me repeat part of it. At that meeting I said, I quote from our report, "We can never regard the Christian and biblical teaching on sexual ethics as anything other than an issue of primary importance, a salvation issue." See, for instance, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 to 11, written by the Apostle Paul. "I said we are called, in the words of the Nicene Creed, to be one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. What the House of Bishops is doing is unholy, contrary to our calling to be holy as God is holy, un-Catholic, contrary to the teaching of the church for 2,000 years, unapostolic, contrary to the teaching of the apostles in the Bible, and is destroying the unity both of the Church of England and of the worldwide Anglican Communion. It puts the eternal destiny of people at risk by leading them astray." We have also drawn to the attention of the bishops the resolution passed last year by the JPC Church Council, the PCC. That resolution includes this. "This PCC of Jesmond Parish Church is dismayed by the proposals from the House of Bishops agreed by General Synod and commended by the bishops of Newcastle and Berwick for prayers for the blessing of sexual relationships outside of God-given marriage between a man and a woman for life, and prays that the House of Bishops might yet change its mind and reject the proposals before they are implemented." as you're probably aware, they have now been implemented. So this plea from us and many other similar pleas from around the country have not been heeded. Why are we speaking like this? Because we can't just listen to the lessons of Paul's teaching and not heed them. They're given to us to put into practice in our own generation and our own context. And if you'd like to hear more on this, one of the things you could do is to listen to the two podcasts that Laura Robb and Fee Jameson have done about these issues with me and also with Liz Jackson. And you can find a link to those in the weekly email. So to sum up, what must we do in response to these four lessons from the Apostle Paul? Collectively and individually, we are to listen to his gospel. We are to believe it because it is the gospel of God. We are to live by it. We are to preserve it with no compromise. And we are to oppose publicly those who deny it in word or deed. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, have mercy on us, we pray. We are so easily swayed by the social pressures that press upon us. We so easily begin to fear men rather than you. Forgive us, we pray. Constantly lead us back by your Spirit to a true repentance and a lively faith in your Son, our Savior, Jesus. Heavenly Father, we praise you for the grace and the freedom that you've given to us in Jesus for all eternity. And we thank you for your servant Paul and for all that you've spoken to us through him. Thank you for the deep repentance and faith that you worked in him. Thank you for calling him to be the apostle to the Gentiles for our sakes. Help us, Lord, to learn from you through him. And teach us always to live to please not men, but you. In Jesus' name we pray.